Let it rain. Let it rain. Open the floodgates of heaven. Let it rain. Let it rain. Open the floodgates of heaven. Sing out. Let it.
Hallelujah. We give glory to the Almighty God for His faithfulness, His goodness, and His mercy upon our lives. Gradually, the year is coming to an end, and this last lap of this exhortation of this year, we trust that songs of victory will start to flow in the life of everyone in the name of Jesus. I trust that the visitation of God these last 6 days will be powerful over every one of us together in the name of Jesus. So today is Tuesday, the 26th day of December. We bless the name of the Lord for that. We acknowledge His name because we've gotten to know that our Lord Jesus Christ came into this world for the salvation of our souls. And the topic of today says, marriage, help us. It is, marriage is to build up, help us. And as we prepare our mind to listen to these, those that are married and those that are yet to get married, let's not just bow our heads as we just worship God, as we magnify His name. Know all the name, like the name of Jesus. Know all the name, like the name of the Lord. Know all the name, like the name of Jesus. Is worthy of glory, is worthy of honor. Is worthy of power and praise. Know all the name, know all the name, like the name of Jesus. Know all the name, know all the name, like the name of the Lord. Oh yes, is worthy of glory. Is worthy of honor, is worthy of power and praise. Just go ahead and bless the name of the Lord for His faithfulness, for the way He has given us Jesus Christ, that He was born so that the sins of man might be dealt with. He gave His only begotten Son out of love. He gave His only begotten Son that whosoever believeth in Him shall not perish. Just give Him glory. Just give Him honor. Just give Him adoration. Because He has given us Jesus Christ. No other name. No other name. It is written, no other name under heaven, whereby man might be saved. Give Him glory. Because Jesus came for our salvation. And hence, my we are thanking Him because through salvation, we have healings, we have deliverance, we have prosperity. Give Him glory. Bless His name. In Jesus' name. Mighty and eternal Father, I want to appreciate You for what You have done for mankind. Thank You for loving us so dearly that You gave Your only begotten Son, that we can say clearly, Lord God Almighty, we now have a means to salvation, a way through out of the darkness of this world. We have a way, my Father, my God, to joy and peace through Jesus Christ. We give You glory. And for the topic of today, Lord, for those that are married and those that are yet to get married, Lord God Almighty, You will speak to us in the name of Jesus, and You will let Your peace, my Father, my God, overrule in all our marriages. In Jesus' name we are prayed. Amen. Welcome to the presence of the Almighty God. Appreciate God for giving us Jesus Christ, His only begotten Son. The memory verse for today says, the heart of her husband doth safely trust in her, so that he shall have no need of spoil. Proverbs 21, verse 11. Proverbs 21, verse 11. talking about a virtuous woman, talking about a woman that has a role to play in a very crucial way in the life of her husband. Says her husband doth safely trust in her. The question is, my sister, can your husband trust in you? Can he trust so that he does not have no need to struggle over any issue of life? So, that's a food for thought. God wants husbands to be able to trust in their wives, and likewise, wives also to be able to trust in their husbands. We need to trust in one another. The Bible passage of today is taken from Proverbs 18:22-24. Proverbs 18:22-24 says, whosoever findeth a wife, findeth a good thing, and obtaineth favor of the Lord. The poor useth entreaties, but the rich answereth roughly. A man that hath friends must show himself friendly, and there is a friend that sticketh closer than a brother. A friend that sticketh closer than a brother. Talk on our topic, marriage, help us. We look at the first verse that we read. Whosoever findeth a wife, findeth a good thing, and obtaineth favor of the Lord. The question is that, why not the Bible says, whosoever findeth a woman? No, because there's a difference between having a woman and having a wife. God says, the man that finds a wife, not a woman, not just somebody to cohabit with. No. Because in today's world now, you have people cohabiting. They are not husbands and wives. They are just cohabiting. That is not the will of God. And the question is, how do I get one? Do I get a wife? Because it can only come from God. It can only come from God. In Proverbs 19 verse 14, Proverbs 19 verse 1 says, house and riches are the inheritance of fathers, and a prudent wife is from the Lord. A prudent wife is from the Lord. A woman that will be a wife can only be gotten from the Lord. And this is the only way whereby favor from the Lord will come upon the man. Because when you get a wife from the Lord, you find a good thing and you obtain favor of the Lord. This is why it becomes very important that one needs to seek the Lord for choice in marriage. It is God that knows how you can live together. He knows the two that can really come together and be one and be compatible and live together to show forth the glory of God. The present situation might not look as if it is possible, but God knows the future. God is the one that has built up the two and knows how, when they come together, they will blend. Because many today, they will just look at the physical. This man is having a good job. I will be a good husband. It does not mean so at all. He might have a good job. She might be beautiful. Anything can happen. But if it is not ordained of God for the two of them to be together, he will find it very difficult. Have you not heard of people who are in prominent positions who got married, and then in 2-3 or 1 year, they have divorced. Why? Because they were not compatible. They could not come together because they are not built together to be able to walk together. But the second verse says, the poor useth entreaties, but the rich answereth roughly. That is, When the poor wants to get into this, he does it with appealing words. He knows that he is poor. He wants to go into it appealing, pleading. You want to marry me? Is it possible that we'll be together? Whether you are poor or not, if it is not the will of God, if I've not sought the face of God towards that marriage, it doesn't matter. And at the same time, the rich, we are told, they are rough in their approach, feeling that they are up to the task. I have the money. I can do it. Whatever she needs. Marriage does not only consist in whatever she needs or he needs. No, it is beyond the physical. There's another tone of the spiritual in the aspect of marriage. Because it was God that said in the beginning, it is not good that man should be alone. And he was the one that provided the woman for the man. And if you have not consulted with God, or you are not consulting with God towards the one to get married to, I pity you. Seek the face of God. God will help us in Jesus' name. Verse 24 says, a man that had friends must show himself friendly. So many complain of not having friends. And this to the fact that they are not friendly. They are not friendly. If you want people to befriend you, look friendly. Be approachable. Be accommodating. Not in the area of sin or unrighteousness, but the way you live your life. There are some people, in the way they live, nobody can easily connect with them. Because in their looks, in the way they live a franny life, franning their faces at all times, you get to know, is this man or this woman in a problem? Does she have some battles in life to fight? All those things we must really put aside and let Jesus reign in our lives. And it just be made clear in this particular passage that there is a friend that sticks closer than a brother. Than a brother. And Jesus is the one. Jesus is the one. I read Proverbs 17:17 to start with. It's a friend loveth at all times, and a brother is born for adversity. Despite this particular statement that a brother is meant for adversity, John 15:15 makes it clear to us that Jesus is much more crucial to us than a brother. He says, henceforth I call you not servants, for the servant knoweth not what his Lord doeth, but I've called you friends, for all things that I have heard of my Father I have made known unto you. Jesus is that friend that is closer to us than our brothers. Hence, make him your friend, make him your Lord. From the body of the study, it says, on the 23rd of this month, the Lord took us to the beginning of his creation to learn that companionship is a major reason why he established the institution of marriage. Because in Genesis 2:18, he said, it is not good that man should be alone. He needs a companion. Yes, God does not want adults to be alone. After marriage, some people refuse to stay in the company of their spouse, giving excuses such as not being compatible with their spouse. Some people, they live far away from their after marriage. They don't stay together. They say, I work in so-and-so place. And how do you want to be compatible when you are not together to start to blend in the ways of your life? How? She stays in her former place alone, and you are staying alone in your place. And occasionally when you come together, you say, I can't understand what she's doing. I can't understand the ways of her. You have not started to stay together. And not started. And again, from the experience of marriage, people who have done some research, they have made us realize that when you are together, even for the first 5 years of your marriage, that is called the adjustment time. You have time to start to adjust to one another. But when you are not together, living differently, different places, how does adjustment come? So, if you knew you were not compatible with your spouse, why did you venture into marriage with him or her in the first place? And how do you know that you'll be compatible? You won't know until you start to live together. Seeing her or seeing him at a distance, doing your courtship and all the rest, does not mean that everything is okay. You have not really studied, you have not started to sleep together, to wake up together, to live in the same room together. So, sometimes the untold underlying reason behind this incompatibility is the gap in educational qualification. That's something like that. Say, she's not educated. Well, you knew that she had that particular educational status before you married. Or that social status. Not to know, she's an introvert and I'm an extrovert. Or things like that. You start to compare. Or that of financial power of the couple. Looking for somebody to wake up in the morning and say, what do you need? Just take. And this man or the wife is now saying, I have to know how to manage our finances very well so that we don't run into trouble. So in such cases, God expects that the one in the advantage position in the relationship would assist the other to climb up until the gap is bridged. That's it. That is what we are talking about on adjustment. You are to help one another, to complement one another. That particular area where your spouse is weak, build him or her up. That particular area where he or she lacks some things, build your partner up. Build her up in that area. Your wife is not number one, is your number one companion. That's it. So the Bible says the two shall be one. They shall be one. Just realize that God has brought us together so that we might live together as one. Some men are always in the company of other women. That is wrong. Not compatible with, you're not compatible with your wife, hence you want to, you always be in the company. That is, it will lead you into a terrible life. Lead you into a terrible life. A woman always in a company of other men. Watch it. Watch it. And you see clearly, as per the instruction of God, that wife you submit to their husbands. You see some women all around, whatever the other men are saying, they submit. They'll be asked to do this. They'll be asked to do this at work. I'll be asked to do this. But when she gets home and the husband says, can we do this? Say, no, we can't do it. But you are submissive to other men in taking instructions. Why not your husband? Why not? So also the men, the Bible says, love your wife. You see them, show affection, show love to other men. And other women at work are in serious trouble. You will see this man say, let us help her. Let us help her. It is not but with ulterior motive, but because at least she should be helped so that you won't run into trouble. This same man will get home. The wife will say, I've just come from work. I'm too tired. You can see this man going out of his place, saying, no, I want this done. I want this done. When the other woman at work showed tiredness, you were the one that said, maybe you can give her a day off. Why not your wife? Why not? Some men are always in the company of other women. This is a violation of God's law on companionship. So, Every one of us as Christians has a need to pray before going into marriage, because the choice is God's. He will be involved in the process of compatibility when he makes the choice for you. And he will make you blessings to one another. And he will make you in such a way that you will complement one another. Moreover, another reason why God established marriage is to raise a permanent helper for the man and vice versa. The term helpmeet used in Genesis 2:18 refers to adequate and appropriate help. Helpmeet, adequate and appropriate in all areas. Adequate and appropriate. That is, at a particular point where you need help, that one, your companion, will be the best to provide it. He or she will be the best, because he has been made a helpmeet for you. In other words, if you obtain your wife or husband from God, you can be assured that God has given you an appropriate destiny helper. I pray for you. Your spouse will be your destiny helper till the end, in the name of Jesus. Do you know that the fortunes of some people improve tremendously after marriage? Do you know that? Because the Bible has made it clear in Deuteronomy 30, verse 32, saying that one will chase 1,000 and two will chase 10,000. Adam could say he had a helpmate because Eve was the bone of his bone and flesh of his flesh. Genesis 2, 21 to 23. So if you marry the right woman God has for you, favor will suddenly reside in your home. At the passage we read in that Proverbs, that when you have the right woman as your wife, it says you have the good thing and you obtain favor from the Lord. Because he that findeth a wife findeth a good thing. It's not he that findeth a woman. It's not he that findeth somebody to cohabit with. It's a wife. And there's a process in making someone a wife. You get married. She will prevent waste of resources in your home and load you with good throughout your lifetime. Proverbs 31 verse 11 and Proverbs 31 verse 12, according to the memory verse. The heart of the husband doth safely trust in her, so that he shall have no need of spoil. This also applies to a woman who marries the right husband. For this reason, it is very important to go to God for your spouse, like Adam received it from God. If you get a spouse from God as a child, as his child, it enhances your prospects of making heaven. 1 Kings 21, 25. When you have your spouse from God, it is clear that that will be a very good means of making it to the kingdom of God. And as much as you want to make it to the kingdom of God, hence, you need to do that. And 1 Kings 21, 25 says, but there was none like unto Ahab, which did sell himself to work wickedness in the sight of the Lord, whom Jezebel, his wife, stirred up. Yes, you can see. Jezebel was the problem in the life of Ahab. Your wife will never be your problem in the name of Jesus. Your husband will never be a thorn in your flesh in the name of Jesus. However, if you get your spouse from friends, relations, computerized matchmaking services, date clubs, or by your own self-will, you may be getting a destroyer instead of a helper. That will never be your portion. So that's where we plead with the young ones. The youths, pray to God so that you will not run into trouble at all. Because Proverbs 14 verse 12, Proverbs 14 verse 12 makes it clear to us that there is a way that seemeth right unto man, but the end thereof is the ways of death. Yes, when you are saying, this is what they do now in this generation. We can go to the website. We can do this. We can do matchmaking. He says it leads to the way of death. It will never be your portion in Jesus' name. When you have the right man as a husband, he will be a crown over you and help you become what God has in store for you. Help is reciprocal. The reason why some people have plunged into hell from the day their marriage started is because they refuse to go to the Creator for Him to help them take that crucial decision that has the potential of determining lives and destiny. So any other method used in obtaining your partner outside of God will hook you up into trouble. Watch it, my brother. Watch it, my sister. And those of us that are parents, let us guide our children. So action point for this is to make the right decision on who to marry. Go to the Creator of all men for help, and He will surely lead you to the right person for you. He knows all people and the contents of their hearts. So let us bow our heads to pray. For the singles, I want you to commit other ways of marriage into the Lord's hand. Just talk to the Almighty God. Lead me in the path of marriage. The one to marry, Lord, I want to marry your perfect will. Talk to the Almighty God. And for we that are married, just talk to the Almighty God. Cry unto God that He will make you compatible. Make you to be compatible with your spouse. Make you to complement one another. Talk to the Almighty God. Make us compatible, O God. Make us, my Father, my God, to complement one another in all areas of life, physical and spiritual. Make us, my Father, my God, to build up one another in the name of Jesus. And for the singles, my Father, my God, we pray that you will lead them. Thank you, God. In Jesus' name we are prayed. Mighty and eternal Father, I want to appreciate and bless your name because you are faithful. Thank you for your word of today. Thank you because as this year is running to an end, you are making it clear to us that for the singles, they have to know that you are the only one who can make them have a peaceful marital life. Father, I pray that everyone that is single, that is looking unto you for marriage, will learn from this and seek your face in the name of Jesus. And you will lead them, Lord, in your perfect will, in the name of Jesus. And for the married, Father, you make every one of us compatible and make us complement one another. Lord God Almighty, that we will be blessings to one another in our marriages in the name of Jesus. And this year, every home will end well in peace and joy. In Jesus' mighty name we are prayed. Amen. Join us as we sing this hymn. God give us Christian home. God bless you. Thank you.
Let it rain. Open the floodgates of heaven. Let it rain. Let it rain. Open the floodgates of heaven. Sing out. Let it rain.